This meeting is being recorded.
This meeting is being recorded.
that we may perfectly know you, and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, the disciples were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native tongue of each other. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days, I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it's the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
Thank you. heavenly dove, rest on our souls. Change us with love. Take away doubts that toss and turn. Let brilliant flames of passion burn. Give us great courage. Use us right now. God, descend and rise in us somehow. Amen. I am a huge fan of theologian Diana Eck, who at 78 is still an iconic professor at Harvard. Her specialty, comparative religion and Indian studies. And I share with her a love of studying across faith traditions, especially in her case and mine, Hinduism. She and her wife, the Reverend Dorothy Austin, became the first same-sex couple to be masters, fancy word for dormitory supervisors, at Lowell House, one of 12 undergraduate residencies at Harvard. Most of all, I love her book, Encountering God, A Spiritual Journey, especially the part that explains how Pentecost was celebrated during the Middle Ages, that bleak period between the 5th and the 11th century, when Rome had been sacked, its empire destroyed, and most people were completely impoverished. Remember, back then, churches and cathedrals were the epicenters of towns and cities, the main and only inspiring buildings where people could go to find joy, beauty, peace, and above all else, art. During these so-called dark ages, some of the most stunning murals and sculptures and stained glass windows were created. Eck shares how Pentecost liturgies back then were way more elaborate than they are now. Sacred spaces had intricately painted domes, vaulted ceilings that encouraged worshipers to look up. And in those raised roofs were placed multiple hidden trap doors used only for Pentecost, nicknamed Holy Spirit Holes. I might add, we already have holes installed in our nave, right? The purpose of them, we don't use that much, to open them up, as Michael shared with me, and let the heat out or the incense out. But back then, Holy Spirit holes during worship meant a select few, I'm sure Michael Duffy would do this for us, climbed out of the roof, sat by the Holy Spirit holes and released live doves through them as choir boys made whooshing and drumming sounds, and then the trapdoors opened again and rose petals rained down on worshipers like tongues of fire. I don't know about you, but the only worship experience I ever had that even came close to that was a wedding here 10 years ago where the groom slash scientist inventor built, with my permission, two air pressured cannons that at the end of the service shot out hundreds of slivers of confetti, which of course me and my staff had to pick up all by ourselves afterwards. And as he and his bride hit the end of that aisle, the cannons exploded, the confetti rained down. His wife's smile was so immense and intense, as was the horror across his new mother-in-law's face. A very mixed bag of emotion. think mixed emotions are always present when it comes to we Christians talking about, comprehending, teaching, explaining the Holy Spirit. Paul Tillich called it the almost forbidden word. French theologian Maurice Landreau, Le Divin Méconnu, the forgotten paraclete. But Eck explains it oh so easily, holding up the power of three strong and resilient images associated in Scripture with the Holy Spirit: breath, fire, and dove. Breath, she explains, is that intimate, iconic, invisible portion of spirit life. We all have breath, right? But we can't see it, yet we know it's there. And John tells us Jesus gives to his disciples this when he breathes on them and says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Fire, Eck explains, is the passion and the power and the punch of the Spirit. And in today's text from Acts, we see that as the disciples get lit with divine fire like human birthday candles. And finally, there's the dove. That images the comfort and the freedom that the Holy Spirit gives us. God descending at Christ's and our own baptism, giving what Philippians terms the peace that passes all understanding. God's Spirit soaring down to us, soothing us, giving us comfort and a clear purpose of how to walk this earth. Additionally, Eck agrees that the Holy Spirit imbues us with what our Hindu brethren call Shakti, energy for life. Poet Rabindranath Tagore, Nobel Prize winner, describes Shakti as the same stream of life that runs through my veins, night and day, runs through the world, dances in rhythmic measures. It is the same life that shoots joy through the dust of the earth, numberless blades of grass, and breaks into tumultuous waves of leaves and flowers. Joyful, life-giving, soul-filling power. We all know what that feels like when we have it, don't we? We've all had it, held it, and then perhaps felt it dissipate. And so then we wait. We hope and we hunger for another moment when this remarkable and indescribable palpable Spirit comes again to energize, mobilize us with the necessary chutzpah to do, pursue, believe, conceive, be better. Last week we heard in Acts chapter 1, Jesus say, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem." So after Jesus ascended into heaven, his followers did what he asked. They returned to Jerusalem to wait. Acts tells us that the disciples, women, Jesus' mother, his brothers, 120 people total were all crammed into the upper room, door closed, shutters drawn, anxiety running sky high. after a while, things began to get stuffy, boring. The group got restless, so they said, let's pause and call a business meeting. Peter, of course, served as parish warden, reminding everyone there was an empty slot on the leadership team, reminding him of all his failings. Judas, remember, his term as a disciple had, for lack of a better word, expired. And thanks to the hard work of the nominating team, Acts tells us that two names were put forth, Barsabbas and Matthias, and that the group prayed, then voted, Matthias won, Judas was replaced, business finished. And then this is where Acts picks up today. Right when the disciples didn't have a clue what to do next. So they just waited some more. Unsure who to be, where to go. We have all been there too, yes? What's crazy is how these 120 faithful followers waited in the stuffy room indoors while thousands, we hear, from multiple nations, which Lynn did a fabulous job speaking out loud, had gathered to celebrate the Festival of Weeks Outdoors, one of the top three holy days of Jewish tradition, a day honoring the divine power coming down, sounds familiar, to Mount Sinai, to Moses, to gift the Torah. Like New Orleans, during Mardi Gras, tourists came from everywhere with one purpose, to party hardy. At daybreak, shofars blew, and I would have loved this job. One priest was handpicked to stand on top of the city walls, waving loaves of bread in each hand, parallel to brandishing flags at the start of NASCAR, a sign celebrating the party should commence. And this was the holiday, people, when faithful Jews were encouraged by their rabbis to drink to excess as a sign of gratitude for God's gift from the vine. Hence the snarky comment we hear from people saying the disciples must be filled with new wine by 9 a.m. The disciples could hear those festivities, and yet they stayed put, refused to join in the party until God rushed in, not just to their room, but into their gloom, their doubts, their insecurities, and gifted every fearful disciple their audacity and tenacity, turning them into fleshed Holy Spirit holes through which God's Spirit could finally be channeled. And that, dear ones, is the message and the miracle of Pentecost, that God came to those flawed and fearful disciples, that God still comes now to us as flawed and fearful disciples to place within us new life, new energy, new hope, if we will just ask and grasp for it. With so much bad news in the news, I always look for the good news. And my favorite gospel news this week was how, perhaps you heard, Rob Hale, part owner of the Boston Celtics, served as a keynote speaker at the University of Massachusetts graduation. Did anybody hear this story? A few? In his speech, Hale proclaimed, "These are turbulent times. More than ever, our community and our world need you, need us to be compassionate." That, that's good, solid stuff, but for Hale, the words were not enough, and so as diplomas were about to be handed out, he grabbed the mic away from the chancellor and spoke again. People, we are proud of you, so along with your diploma, you're going to get two envelopes, one that says gift and one that says give. And then Hale proceeded to give every graduate $1,000 cash. $500 to keep, $500 to share with a person or an organization who, as Hale put it, could use it more than you. I did the math. 2,500 students graduated from UMass Boston, so Hale gave out a $2.5 million that day, which I'll say is a small drop in Hale's total bucket worth of $5 billion. But as my elder teen and I were taking a leisurely drive yesterday, we wondered, will those graduates actually take up the charge? Will they actually share the gift and give? And so on Pentecost, we all are asked that question. Will we take up that charge to share the gifts we have been given? Lord, you call us all to be Holy Spirit wholes. May our lives become like trapdoors through which your divine compassion and passion, your presence and power passes from you into the world through us. Amen.
We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God of God, light of light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate in the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Prayers of the People are Form 6. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. for all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek it for truth.
For our presiding bishop and our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God and God's church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, hear us, Lord.
For your mercy and grace.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life.
We will
exalt you, O God our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
Let us pray for all God's people throughout the world, including the needs and concerns of this community. For the clients, staff, and volunteers of the 1269 Cafe. For the residents of the Beach Street Shelter as funding dwindles. For all refugees and their supporters. For all elected officials in every level of government, and all church leaders in every order of ministry. Continued prayers for the Anderson family, and for all who travel on this holiday weekend. For whom else shall we pray?
For Jim Lee, recovering from knee surgery.
For Lynn, Carol, Elizabeth.
For Jane.
For all who are facing professional challenges. I ask your prayers for all in need of God's healing power. For Brenda, Carrie, Kate, Autumn, Chrisanne, Sally, John, Lori, Kate, Frank, Judy, Mary Alice, Dick, Warren, Betsy, Mike, Joanna, Nathan, Michael, Sarah, Joe, Linda, Leona, Jacob, Beth, Marie, Usman, Susan, Ross, Ed, Mary Lou, Jean, Ann, Greg, Bob, Anne-Marie, Noel, Marie, Peg, Gail, Mike, Tricia, and Arlene. For whom else shall we pray?
For Kate and Kate.
I ask your prayers for all who have died, remembering especially Deborah Clark and all those who gave their lives in service to this country.
Amen.
May the souls of the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace and let light perpetual shine upon them. For whom else shall we pray? Let us give thanks for all the blessings of this life, especially the lives and memories of those in whose honor the flowers and sanctuary light are given, Katina Scotus, Adam Plantania, and Constance Bevan. Thanksgiving for all who are graduating. For what else shall we give thanks?
Thanksgiving for Quinn Turner's 14th.
Thank you. Lord, we pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful
Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins,
known and unknown,
things done and left undone.
And so hold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace. Thank you for it.
Thank you.
I mean, we'll put some icing hot on there.
Peace, everybody.
Peace, all. Oh, look, there are folks in there. Jim Higgins is in there.
Peace and a glorious weekend.
Yeah. Peace, everyone. Peace, all. Oh, gloomy, yeah, no. Wait. Chris.
Oh, that's nice.
No?
Come, O Lord, Jesus, Lord, take heed to your soul.
always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. In fulfillment of his true promise, the Holy Spirit came down on this day from heaven, lighting upon the disciples to teach them and to lead them into all truth, uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith and giving to your church the power to serve you as a royal priesthood and to preach the gospel to all nations. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Michael, Constance, Katina, Adam, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
people of God.
Thank you.
us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted of us
as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us spiritual food and sacrament of the body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ has given us the victory, give you joy and peace in your faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Picture of both of them from Laundry Love. I have it up in the Great Hall. I also have a card. If you would like, please sign the card. I'm going to keep it here for another week. I know it's Memorial Day weekend. And if you want to bring a card in, if you want to sign it next week, that's fine. I'm going to leave it inside the kiosk for the whole week. and I'll give it to Christine, you know, in about 2 weeks. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. So we do have coffee hour this week, thanks to Linda Lassan, so please join us for that. Those of us who are in our Zoom room, we intended to have drive-by today, but I know there's a lot of people who aren't going to be here, so we just want to do a check-in. If you can message Shelley and say you're coming, that'll really help us, because I know one person's in Long Island who's a usual customer, and one's had knee surgery who's a usual customer, so just let us know if you're coming, so we can be outside waiting for you. Also, in the back, there's still Pride sign up. We're looking for people to help man our booth, so please sign up for that. And please also don't forget the cookout next week, and sign up for that to bring something. Do you have any advice on what to bring? No? Okay. Yep. Yourself and aside, right? Oh, something. Yeah, it's like a brunch cookout, that's right. So you, maybe you want to go for more the breakfast rather than the lunch routine, so, yep. But I can always eat a burger myself. So, all right. Anything else?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, more.
I would just like to remind you all that we are planning to use your favorite hymns this summer, and the sign-up sheet is on the grand piano in the Great Hall. If you have yet to sign up, you are encouraged to do so today. Also, for those in the Zoom chapel, in the parish newsletter, there's an article about the summer hymn plans and my email address to send me your choices from the hymnal or Wonder, Love, and Praise. There are hymnals and the Wonder, Love, and Praise books on the piano. Thank you.
Okay. Go in peace, love, and serve the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.